Welcome to Thriller Bitcoin.
Welcome to Thriller Bitcoin.
I guess the main goal of those visuals are to blow Bitcoiners away. That's the primary intent behind the action of doing this representation of Bitcoin. It's hopefully to have the most accurate representation of Bitcoin that's verifiable. And if it doesn't blow your mind away because of just the visuals, it should blow the mind away, at least because it's real Bitcoin data.
I think the thing that really struck me when you showed it to me was just how ambitious it was. So ambitious, Pedro. It was like super ambitious. Where did this idea come from? Were you just walking down the park one day and then you were like, hey, a leaf fell, and then you thought of Bitcoin? And like where did this amazing idea come from?
The idea itself, I think it just comes from what other people had, the same urge, but they represent Bitcoin in their own way. Usually people start with text, and I read people's text. They describe it in a visual way, even though it's just prose, and I just take note of that mentally, and then I hear other people do it in a more technical way and building for a website or an interactive visualization, and that's also something to be learned. And I think the only thing that this project is doing a little different, I think, is that it's trying to put it in the film format, in a long feature film, that I don't think there's any Bitcoin film being done like that. Everything is either documentary format or I guess there's been mentions of Bitcoin in fiction, but we haven't had like the Bitcoin fiction or the Bitcoin nature documentary.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, for the people that are listening at home, Pedro is making this thing called The Anatomy of Bitcoin. I got the title right, right? Yeah. But the interesting about it is it reminds me, did you ever see those Nova kind of shows that were on PBS? And they were super popular, but it would show you the galaxy and the stars, and it's just narrated really like calmly and precise. And then it just shows these visuals. That's just like inspiring. I just remember seeing those in school and being like, whoa. And when I saw what you were creating, it was, it had similar feelings of like wonderment. And can you just talk about like not just how you build through these things, but like how you would explain that to somebody who's like driving or listening right now? Like, how would you explain those visuals in that way?
I think like you, I was probably also inspired by something like that. There's a video or a short film project called Powers of 10, where the viewer is presented with a couple in a park having a picnic, and every 10 seconds, the camera zooms out, or just moves out 10 to the power of 10 meters and so on, to go to reveal the Chicago city area, then United States, Earth, solar system, universe, and known universe. But then it goes back and does the opposite, and it explores the known universe until you reach the atom. So you take the human scale at the middle, and you go as far as you can go and as close as you can go. And I thought that made me really kind of become a little amazed with the scale of the universe, at least how we understand it, and also of the minuscule scale of things. And I thought it would be just cool to have something done in the same vein, but with Bitcoin in mind.
Yeah. And so for the listeners at home, again, like, it's hard because we're it's audio only podcast. So it's going to be hard to describe this, but it reminded me of, we have a lot of music fans that listen to the show, like Bjork. And I think I told you this first time we talked, like Bjork made this app when like the app store started taking off, but it had music attached to it. And depending on how you pushed on this app, the song would change or like it would adjust. And when I think of like your project, obviously it's not an app. Doesn't mean it couldn't be an app, but it's this film that when you, it feels interactive of a sort. It feels like it's not trippy or anything like that, but it does for me. I was thinking of like, you know, I don't know, like Pink Floyd, like that type of like imagination and that type of like discovery. And how the music and the visuals like are married to each other in a way. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think music is such an important component, and eventually the dream with this is to imagine a good way to convert the data and the conditions of Bitcoin to derived the actual score of the film from the data itself. But right now, depending on how you parse the data, the sounds it produces are kind of random. So you need someone to actually translate, someone that knows a little bit of data extraction and parsing it with code, but also of music, to associate different meanings to different notes or instruments or lengths. And I guess that's what I'm trying to do with the image component, is extract data and use that data from Bitcoin to position geometry around in a space that follows the conditions of the rules existing in Bitcoin. So that for people that are into Bitcoin and recognize the rules of Bitcoin, it's cool because you might recognize the rules of Bitcoin in the shapes. The shapes are not positioned arbitrarily. That's my point. There's a lot of crazy AI visualizations of stuff. There's a lot of artifice in movies. I look at the budget of visual effects of movies, and it's crazy. It's where all the narrative is being constructed is in the computer, but they're only showing you fantasy stuff, and it's random, and it looks real, but it's completely, there's no, and you know it's fantasy, and you accept it, but what this film is trying to do is trying to actually just show the pure information of Bitcoin and claim that that's like a visualization that's more truthful, because you can actually take the code and run it and verify that it generates that the same geometry with your same data. So you're welcome to change it to fit your vision. But this is obviously a little bit of my interpretation, because I'm the one that's trying to, I'm the one that's putting the numbers that break and move stuff around. So obviously it's going to be kind of my own vision.
Yeah. And that's the thing that I think, to me, when I think of like low budget filmmaking and the people that have been able to go from like low budget filmmaking to then doing like $100-300 million budgets, it's always like, I can think of Gareth Edwards. Gareth Edwards, what he made that movie Monster for like 17K or 20K. And he was able to create this whole story around Monster, and like, and he went to like Mexico and he filmed everything, but he did visual effects for some media company. I forget which one it was. Long story short, once he released that, found a couple good actors and released it, super popular indie hit in the 2000s. And then he got offered to do Godzilla. And then he went and did this big budget Godzilla movie, and it was a super smash success. You know, the first one, or the first one, not the Matthew Broderick one, but the one after that. And then after that, then he did Star Wars, the Rogue One, I think was the one that the, anyways. So what my whole point is, like, sometimes when you have like a limited budget and you're a super creative individual, it's actually in your, it's a better, it's probably better for you, because it makes you even be more like creative. Can you talk about stuff like that? Like how are you kind of working through all this?
You think I'm going to end up working for Disney in a couple of,
I mean, they're going to get on Bitcoin too at some point, you know?
I don't know. In the beginning, I was either really naive or really cynic, I don't know. But I thought this project would sell itself, and companies like Tesla and stuff like that would invest. And a lot of these, then I realized that a lot of these companies are actually not very interested in showing this film, because first of all, it really only appeals to Bitcoiners, because for everybody else, they don't know what they're looking at. So you need to be open to Bitcoin to actually ask why the shapes are that way. So Netflix doesn't really have a vested interest in that necessarily, because all the content they put out, it's not really compatible with that. Like, ultimately the goal of this film is to basically make the viewer realize that they should turn off Netflix and go work for Bitcoin.
That's good.
But yeah.
Do you think budget's going to get in your way? Because one of the things that we first talked about was how much you were going to need to actually get this project off the ground. Is that something that's severely holding you back, or is that something that you could work through?
I think if there was more money, it would probably be easier to make it faster, because I spend a lot of time researching, because I don't necessarily know any of the stuff I'm doing. And there's not a lot of, actually there's a lot of documentation, and there's a lot of people doing stuff that's very similar to what I'm doing. So it's very, and they're sharing their information. So really this is taking from the open source Blender groups that share their information about just manipulating 3D. And then the Bitcoin people, they also share everything about parsing data. So I'm just mixing the two. And if there was more time, I could obviously pay a Bitcoiner or some other 3D artists to do these things, and I could just do other stuff. But at the same time, this is moving at the pace of my own research, which is kind of good, because it also allows me to do other stuff that help with the research. Like, all the work I do in Bitcoin kind of serves the different positions serve each other. So if I'm designing some other project for Bitcoin, it's informing this, and this project is informing the others. I'm sure that you probably have felt something similar, because I've seen consistently that Bitcoiners tend to work on multiple different areas.
Yeah, we tend sometimes to our detriment. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, but also it's very empowering, because you can mock something up really fast and release it, and then just build it from the ground up. You don't need to go like specialize in doing one thing for someone else.
Yeah, it's a real proof of work kind of ecosystem. It really is. It's just, and then you pick up different skill sets along the way. It's ever evolving. And then also it just moves at a rapid, much rapid pace than any other industry I've worked for. Do you think that's also true for you?
I think yes, but I don't think that rapid pace has reached Bitcoin video and TV and film, and I think we're still it's starting now. But for instance, the acceleration that happened in Lightning, which I think it's still going to accelerate a lot more, but I don't think we see that competition, fierce competition, to be creating the next best live action. I think we're getting to that in the documentary field. It's getting kind of like everybody's documentarian now, and everybody's shooting a Bitcoin documentary. So at some point it's going to be even more competitive, and maybe people will start doing fiction. But for that to accelerate, you need the writers to come in, you need the like producers, and unfortunately the fiat propaganda machine, it's much faster and has a lot of money too.
Yeah, for sure. I think some people know that we do some media stuff here at a Plub Lab, and like for us just internally, we've had to invest in a lot of wires and cables and just equipment and gear and headphones. Like, it's just, you think about it, even Logan's investing in his own camera stuff and different lenses that we have and we need. And it's a lot. And now we've reached a point, at least internally, where we're actually going to need to hire another like production assistant, basically, to help with like location scouting and stuff like that. Just because it's getting to a point where some of the stuff is just, it's more work than just like one or two people can handle. Like you really, I don't think people know this, so you can talk more about this, but it really takes a team to put together like a film project. Can you talk about that?
Yeah. And I think you're doing a great, you're putting a great piece of content out, which I guess maybe Spiral is also doing that, which is the comedic informative content that's really fast paced and really it's relaxed. It's a nice relaxed way of, but again, it's, do you expect, maybe you're a little bit more public facing, but it's content that appeals primarily to Bitcoiners. Hopefully it's so captivating that appeals to non-Bitcoiners, because you also want to bring people in. And that's why I also try to do stuff. I would love to be able to compose the music that will captivate and hypnotize the non-Bitcoiner to watch the film and feel something, but I don't know how to compose. So you need to talk to someone that's going to be doing music, and you need to talk with, I'm also not a writer. Like, I have an idea of the film I want to see, but I don't know how to write the text that actually captivates people. So you need a writer. And this is only, I'm cheating because I'm just doing digitally. It's mostly computers. I don't have a set. My cameras, I don't need to buy a lens. I can just go to 300 millimeters like that. something. I can even go to 3 meter focal length.
Wow.
But when it becomes a live act, like in physical space, it's like it's going from software to actually mining, like hardware, or it becomes a whole different thing. And then the teams, they need to be at the same place at the same time, which is very expensive. For Anatomy of Bitcoin, you can be anywhere, work from the movie doesn't really have a schedule. But your content is much more appealing and much more recognizable because it's just a bunch of people having fun doing Bitcoin shit and inviting you, which is really, you need a human character for that. You can't do that in 3D.
Yeah. I think is just like Austin in general. Most people don't know this, but like in Austin, there's a big film community here. Like they film really big shows around here and stuff. And some of my personal friends on the Fiat side used to do, you know, work for those places and stuff. So it's always been a part of Austin. There's some famous directors are from here. That's how me and Logan met. Like we were both fans of film and all that stuff. Nice. And he also was a Bitcoiner. I was a Bitcoiner. And that was just something that we just really vibe with. And even to this day, me and him will talk about all sorts of things, you know, just on the film side or just the production side. And he's somebody that I got very lucky who I just met, you know, and he has the same kind of determination and he wants to make high quality stuff too. Obviously, we're trending that way. I don't know if we're there yet, but we're getting there. But it's I think for me, the first step is just really being able to take that, you know, say, oh no, I can stand and do this too as well creatively. Can you talk about that? Can you talk about why you feel so confident you can get this done as far as a film?
Because I think just like any other Bitcoiner, I'm just applying the skills I earned through my fiat life and I'm trying to make use of all of them. And it's crazy, but this is the only thing. If you put all my experiences together, this would be the only thing. It's what I like. Just I like film and I like epic stuff that explains things to me. That's how I get like dopamine, is when I go from feeling dumb to feeling like I can actually, stuff makes sense. And I also like photography. I like Bitcoin. I thought I liked data, but Bitcoin made me at least use the love of data and writing code to parse it. Even though most of the stuff I do is just copy-paste, it's still because you're putting a lot of pieces together. You make it your own and you have to understand them and you have to trial and error. So you end up learning a lot. And I think even though I don't think I ever will become an expert because I'm focused on too many things. I think actually a lot of these things are accessible. Anybody can do it. It just takes a lot of work. It does take a lot of work. It's going to be, it's like you need to really like it. You need to I don't think you're doing anything differently. You have love for shooting stuff and maybe interacting with the actors and in the production and whatnot. It's like now you're trying to monetize that love for Bitcoin. So you do it for Bitcoin.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. I think what's interesting is about when I talk to creatives and stuff like that, a lot of us do it just out of strictly the love of the craft, or we've been doing it for free for most of our lives and, or for fun. And then, you know, it's not until you get into your a lot older in life, people actually want to pay you for it. But that hasn't always been the case, at least for me. You know, in the early days, you know, no one wanted to pay me for anything. But, now all of a sudden you show that, you know, because you create multiple pieces of things, whatever they are, whether it's a startup or whether it's just like a a painting or whatever, it's a drawing or whatever. And it's not until you find that one thing that people actually see value in, you know, and they're just like, oh, we want to pay you for that, to keep doing more of that. And that's the thing that I always found surprising. Can you talk about that? Where have you found that in your career, where you've been able to finally go from the early days of a creative person to now you're actually getting paid for it?
I followed a very standard path. I was very lucky that I found myself a little bit, not by accident, but I moved to New York, and then I moved out, and going through that process, I was able to see the different design, what do you call, like the job markets, and how people, I worked with a lot of colleges, even in my couple of first jobs, a lot of our clients were from education. And if you follow a certain path, and there's always going to be demand for something, and some, like, it just happens that design, my background is in design, communication design, which is, it sounds a little confusing, but it's not confusing, or maybe just a little, it's not graphic design because it's more focused on communication. So it's a little more broad. And I've always loved that idea of, that was indoctrinated in me in a public college in Portugal, where I'm from, that you needed to be more open to any aspect of, if I really couldn't do 3D and code, I would probably be also behind the camera trying to do stuff, because I would have to express it somehow. I dread the production. It scares me.
The post-production, like, or just like the setup of it all?
No, it's set up, getting everybody on time. Like, my wife does that, and that's not how my brain works. I would miss it. It's too complicated, and I also don't direct people well. So I try to act. I act terribly. So there, it's very hard. I pretty much, the only position I would have in the, in a crew like yours would be probably in lighting or something. That's where I actually really like production, like backstage stuff. But moving stuff around and just being part of something. But if you just want to go and make money, there's always going to be demand for designers somewhere. Mm-hmm. And if it's not designers, it's going to be the next thing. So to be creative and monetize it, you either go to Fiat, and there's always going to be like a big brand that's going to be open to sit you in a chair and do their whatever banners and whatever. And I did that for a while. That allowed me to get paid a little bit. I bought some Bitcoin, and then I went up a little bit more in the career, very, very standard path. And then one day I just thought that I was working too much, because I would stop my Fiat job and go home and work on Bitcoin. It's not work, but I was at my computer doing Bitcoin stuff, and I wasn't being paid. So I thought that I can't work two jobs and have one that doesn't pay. So it's better to be paid to work in Bitcoin. So I stopped, and I think I came right at the end of the period of, there were not that many designers in Bitcoin. So I got a job in BTC Inc., Bitcoin Magazine, but I just worked for the conference, and that allows me to do a lot of work also for the film, because then I also use some of the knowledge that I learned from the film, and footage and geometry generated from the film, to then make more Bitcoin themed backgrounds for the stages and for the graphics overall in the conference. But that's as far as I've monetized this film. hopefully the dream, I think, for any Bitcoiner that wants to be paid for their work is to have like gigantic and enormous anonymous donation with no strings attached. But until then, I'm trying to establish a presence on Noster to also have, if sometimes some people will zap some posts, which is also validating. And it's all, I have the projects on all the other Bitcoin fundraising projects like Geyser and Telecoin. But what I learned is that it actually takes a lot of work to then market and make those things work. It's not, it doesn't, if someone tells you that you just need to set up an account and then magically the stuff will flow in, no, it's, people don't even know that the account has been set up. So,
yeah, absolutely. I think the discovery part of all those platforms that you just mentioned severely lack, right? They're just not very good about promoting some of the less known projects, less known people in the space, but probably,
Yeah, but that's, they're also running an attention seeking platform. They want the hottest. It's normal. Like Noster, for instance, Noster is in that way is brutal for the newcomer. It's you're not even connected. So, but in the end, it, yeah, I think coming on shows like yours and just talking about it, I think eventually there's going to be interest enough that the money will be raised. And I've already raised a little bit of money, so I can't really complain. And that money can then be used to pay. I've hired a Bitcoin graffiti to parse the UTXO state. And I've paid a couple of people I've met on Blender forums to write me the script that I was blocked and I needed help to write script to set the geometry in spiral. And that money usually comes from donations or it comes from me, but it's been... On Geyser Fund, I've raised enough money to make somebody do a piece of code that it was taking me weeks and weeks of trial and error.
That's good. I mean, you're getting some traction. Hopefully this podcast will help. I think it will. Call me crazy.
Everything helps, especially if people, because you're also from maybe the audience you attract might be overlapping with the audience that I'm trying to reach.
Yeah, I definitely have a more creative audience. It's a lot of startup, a lot of founders listen to it, VCs, stuff like that. Not really popular with like, you know, the larger Bitcoin crowd, but I think there's other podcasts for that, but very niche podcasts here. But it's growing. It's growing, Pedro. What was I going to say? So let's talk about, because you said a lot there, but I want to go back to what you were saying that you were making with Bitcoin Conference. Because some of those, dude, those graphics, man, I told you when we were talking initially, like I walk into that conference, that's like one of the things that makes me feel like it's, we're at another big thing. It's just how, what is the right word? It's just how like, it almost feels like you're going into like a journey, like it just feels so like, that's always one of the coolest things about the Bitcoin conference, you know, is how like immersive the videos and all that kind of soundstage stuff looks and feels. Is that by design? And like, where do you specifically help with that?
Yeah, that's definitely by design. I'm at the Bitcoin conference. I'm a part of the team, the experience team. And Pat Riley is the lead and he's kind of defining the vision and how we want people to feel. Usually no, but overall we want people to feel as welcome as possible. And I think a big component of that is to try to create a moody, very emotional scene, which for me, that's how I think it's, I connect to places, but I know for a fact that not everybody connects to a place like that, because a lot of people don't, they're not very sensitive to that, or they're sensitive to other things that I am not sensitive towards. But then these ideas, for instance, in the last Bitcoin 2023, the whole idea was to take Bitcoin as the center of the conference. And it has this gravitational clock idea that Michael, which is the lead designer at our team, he developed this concept of rings rotating, and the different rings would have different inscriptions and different meanings. And we had the geometry, and everything was built in Blender, and the animations of the solar flares make it look like we're all staring into the sun. And then there's these elements that all have Bitcoin meaning in them, are rotating very slowly at a very slow pace in the background of a starry sky, deep in the galaxy kind of set. And I think it was really cool to make that, because it allows you to go and research all those Bitcoin curiosities that you would be researching anyway. So, and you hope that people will notice, but then also people are focused on so many other things, because that conference is an atomic bomb of attention stuff, like you're stimulated from every single point. It's very confusing.
That's all. But one of the things that always grabs me, I don't know if you're working for them at the time, but that Ross, I think it was in 21 or maybe it was 20 when Ross did the whole, you know, call from from prison, and then how it was visually displayed. I remember walking in the room to go there, and then for a moment I just stopped and just like watched the room. Everybody was seated, everybody was like highly attentive, and the visuals and how you guys represented that call, it was just like, I remember looking and thinking like, wow, this is a moment, we're all experiencing a moment together, and you could feel it in the room. And I think visuals and the audio and everything, I think that was a memorable moment for me.
I wasn't working at the time. I think that was Tommy who made that, but I'm not completely sure.
But that's what Bitcoin Conference does. There's these moments where you walk in the room and it's just all the visuals and everything.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if anybody likes this term mega church, but I think everything is a mega church. If you go to a political rally, it's a mega church. They have their ways, Hollywood ceremony, mega church celebrations, award winning, and all kinds of celebrations. And I think Bitcoiners, because the Bitcoin crowd is so diverse, you can really do anything, because there's always going to be people that are going to be offended. There's going to be people that are going to not understand, but you can do anything. Nobody's going to say, oh, that's not, I mean, obviously there's ways you can kind of botch the message.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think if you're true to Bitcoin, people are going to accept even lighthearted goofiness. It's whatever, as long as it respects the Bitcoin way.
Yeah, 100%. I think you're totally right. I mean, look at us. Like, we're...
Man.
There's no reason why they should accept us. But they do.
Yeah, the goofier... I think the goofier, the better, because it's exactly the opposite from the other side, which is...
Yeah, right. Kind of
boring, blue-gray tonality that doesn't change, and monotonic... and very serious and very uptight. So we know that that doesn't mean much. So why not do the opposite?
Yeah, I would say, like, at least the group of Bitcoiners that I came in with were like the 2020, 2021 Bitcoiners. And all of us are just all about fun. Like, we just want to have fun. Obviously, we're not 7 years in or 10 years in yet. So we're not those doomer Bitcoiners. Like, you know, those guys, like, there's those people exist. And, but I think it's good because you see this new entrance of people and they're like little puppies. They're like, yeah, they're having fun. They're as Bitcoiners. And then you're like, wait till you get in year five and year six, you're going to be so jaded.
We'll see. I think it comes and goes. I think there's a way for someone to experience all those states, but also to come in and out of them. Almost, I think actually what Bitcoin gives you is that it gives you a little liberty to self-induce those states if you want more seriousness in your life. It's more of a choice. It's not a condition. But you can also choose to have more seriousness for a period and then come out of it. And you can do that in the cycle of 1 year or throughout the day. But as long as you're doing that choice because you want to. Yeah, I don't think.
Yeah, I think that was one of the things that for me, I remember when some of the advice I got, because I took over CEO last year, some of the people, you know, my friend group were like, Car, you need to stop doing your podcast. Don't do that. Like, don't mix your podcast with your thing. And I remember thinking, I was like, why? Why would I stop? I like talking to people. I want to know more about who these people are. Like, and I remember thinking at the time, I was like, oh, maybe they were just saying that you're going to spread yourself too thin or something. But I remember thinking, it's like, it's not hard to talk to people for an hour. And then for me, I'm so fast on the production side and the uploading side. Mm-hmm. Like, that takes me like 10 minutes. I got a whole process. And that's where I realized, I'm like, I think some people look at it more as more work. But for me, when I do these type of things, it's, I want to talk about your project, Pedro. Like, I want to help you get more people involved in it. Like, and then not only that, I just want to see what type of person you are. And maybe there are other people that want to listen to that too. How do you separate yourself from like your regular job and then what you do with this? Like, how do you separate that? Do you separate it? Do you kind of work with it together?
I try to mix as much as possible. So whenever I'm working on something, I'm working on all of them. But also, when I say all of them, I mean a movie about Bitcoin, an application for Bitcoin, a game for Bitcoin, and a Bitcoin conference. Those are the projects that I'm trying to help at least build. And this is going to sound fanatic, but if you just work for Bitcoin, anything you do will benefit all the other things you do.
Tell us why. Because not enough people know this. Tell us why.
Well, because anything you do for Bitcoin will advance your knowledge of Bitcoin, which will enable you to potentially get more Bitcoin easier by establishing more connections with Bitcoiners, because ultimately Bitcoiners have the Bitcoin. I'm not expecting JP Morgan to send me some Bitcoin, but I'm expecting some fellow Bitcoiners to send me from 21 to 21,000 sets a couple of times. And if they all do it, like, for me, the dream is to either have a lump, like a super big donation, or thousand trillions of small donations. And I think if you just find your place in Bitcoin, if it's raising cattle or shooting videos with teaching people how to coding yourself, at some point then you go to a meetup and you start a project with some other person that's doing something, because people don't have one single passion. I think it takes you need the whole range, the full experience to actually feel somewhat, like, how do you say, not content, but
like you're living a full life.
Yes, and you'll never have it all, because as soon as you fill it in, it grows. So, but the objective is to fill it in. And if you just do that one thing that you just do really good, okay, you might be the best. But then I don't know if you do the other stuff. Not sure. This is a little, I don't know exactly if I believe what I'm saying, but I'm not the best on anything. So I don't have gold medals, but I also never tried to get the gold medal. And now the goal is to get more Bitcoin, or to at least do more Bitcoin work, because that's what I like to do. And the problem with Bitcoin work is that you go and you meet other Bitcoiners and there's so much opportunity. Everybody needs something, because mm-hmm. everybody's doing multiple things.
Yeah.
So it's crazy. Like, there's so much opportunity.
Yeah.
People see it.
Yeah. It's interesting that I think of so many different things just by what you said right there. I think, yeah, just about everybody needs something. At least for us here at Plobab, that's why it's so important for let people come in here and then find their path. Because like you said, everybody needs something. So whether if you're a developer, guess what? You're going to find a job right away. Or if you're a designer, well, guess what? There's people that need designers. Or you just make websites. Guess what? We're going to plug you into somebody that needs that, and then you're going to get paid. So that's why I always say, like, man, just come to Plobab and you'll come and make something. And then the second thing that you really touched on that I really thought was interesting was the aspect of, like, yeah, like, how do you separate these things? And I think you're right. I don't think you do. I think there, at least for me, it all just, like, is together. I was just talking about this with somebody in the lab earlier today, and we were talking about how, like I have my life, and I always thought, like, oh, I have to wait to start it. I have to wait to actually go and do these things I want to do outside of my job and what I do for a living. And then I realized, I was like, no, it's already started. I'm already, like, it's always going to be something else. Like, there's always going to be the next thing. And I think there's tons of books that talk about this, but I think the way, at least here in the startup space where I'm around, and, you know, I think it's, you kind of have to get used to that type of, like, pressure and that type of that thing that's always that you feel is insurmountable. And then at a certain point, you just got to say, no, this is just my life, and just get adjusted to those obstacles. That there'll be another obstacle next month. And it's just going to be a harder and harder obstacle as time goes on. And that's okay. But it doesn't mean you stop your life to figure out these things. And that's something I'm just barely coming realizing. I was just talking to somebody about this earlier. So it's fascinating. Can you relate to that?
Yeah, absolutely. It's I think this is a little bit of I found myself before I started working almost exclusively on Bitcoin, that I was leaving a routine that I wanted to end by the end of the day, so I could turn off, recharge, and start again. Mm-hmm. And every day would be a constant reset. And because the interval between stopping and restarting was getting just shorter and shorter, you start feeling like you have no control and you have no time for yourself. But imagine if you switch that around and you think that you just, every single moment, you're just improving on whatever you're doing, because you're always living your life, because you're investing in yourself. So when you're resting, you might be thinking about things that you like that are going to benefit you, instead of dreading the day that you're not having something that's going to benefit the boss or whatever. And I think it's okay to have a boss. I have bosses, but it just happens that their vision is aligned with mine, so I don't mind helping them. But imagine doing that with someone that has their vision opposite to yours. It's gonna drive you crazy. So it's not that it makes life easier, but it makes it more bearable, at least. And I think you do stuff with more joy if you're doing it knowing that ultimately it's benefiting you primarily, but it also will benefit everybody around you, and even everybody around the world. I think in the fiat world, your work will benefit you a little bit in the short term because you're being paid and you have that security, but you're stuck to the routine. And you potentially, especially if you're into Bitcoin, you know that it's not benefiting you as a like civil servant or whatever. And it's not, well, who is it benefiting? So if you know that and you go home, obviously you're going to want to turn off. You want to separate that as much as possible. Otherwise you go crazy.
Yeah, for sure. Let's talk about Anatomy of Bitcoin. Where can people go to support that project? Is it just Geyser? Is it just, yeah, tell us.
Yes, we're on Geyser. We can also go to anatomyofbitcoin.com. There's a BTC Pay server running. And if you really like the project and if you feel like you can help raise money or write or compose score, any help is welcome. And there's so much to do. And the great thing is that you don't need to work on it exclusively. You can work on it your own time. It's your own project as much as my own, because everything is trying to be done as open source and distributed as possible.
Nice. Yeah. For the people listening at home, take my word for it. Like, I was really impressed. It takes a lot to impress me, believe it or not. Like, it really does. Like, especially, you know, I was talking to somebody about the other day about this. They were like, Carr, why don't you ever talk negative about things? And I was like, because I don't like talking about terrible stuff. Like, I only want to talk about good stuff or stuff that I just don't have the brain power to think about ugly things or terrible things. And I only want to talk about beautiful stuff. And when I saw your project, when you showed it to me, I was like, wow, it's like, this is impressive. Like, I wish I would have came up with it. But it's so good, dude. I hope we can get this funded. How much more do you need?
Any amount helps. It really depends on how much more of the project you want to see done. If you, for instance, have a bunch of money and you say, hey, I want you to have this much ready by the before the halving. Well, it's going to be hard. It's really hard to say. I think it's, imagine how much a movie costs to make. And I can promise that this one can be done much more efficiently. So divide that by 10 or mm-hmm. with inflation, maybe 100. And that in Bitcoin, paying for like 2 years of my life plus a little bit of other people part-time, mm-hmm. I think we could get this done like for real.
Okay.
I don't know how much that is as a set number, because we can also go so high and we can hire a whole VFX house team to do this amazing stuff that they're usually doing for Marvel. And we take all that compute power and we apply it in Bitcoin and we hire a proper director and a whole team and we go like full production.
Yeah. I've noticed at least in what I've done is people give you a small budget, and then once you've proven that, then they'll give you a little bit bigger budget. And then once you've proven that, they'll give you a much bigger budget. So that's what I've been able to. Maybe you can skip all that, Pedro. Just go straight to the big budget.
No, I know this is going to be a hard sell. I know Bitcoiners are very attached to their Bitcoin, and I think it's good that I think it might even be good that this project doesn't get an intense amount of funding suddenly. I think it's good to have the sustained support throughout the years, because it's also not something that I necessarily want to rush. But obviously, it would be nice. For me, the urgency is really, I think potentially this has it can be the way people start thinking about Bitcoin. visually in their brains when they're talking about the protocol. So potentially it's a good opportunity to be engraving ourselves in the minds of people. But also I think it could be also a film that inspires people to turn into Bitcoin much more, much faster.
Absolutely.
So one hour and a half experience kind of will potentially explain and entertain you and keep you hooked with the right camera work, the right direction, the right script. And then you come out of the other end, like if you had watched Forrest Gump or something like that.
I would say it's this. This is how I would pitch it. But you tell me if I'm wrong. To me, it reminds me of like the Nova stuff, the PBS stuff, like all that stuff. But I'll take it even a step further. There's a possibility that this could be like a 2001 Space Odyssey type of thing where it starts off and it's so visually appealing and people don't know what to make of it. They just know that they watch something profound. And if you add the narration, like let's say if you get like Safe or some of these other people to do some of the narration parts of this, like this could be like one of those films that you then send to, you know, whoever. And yeah, like you said, this could be one of those films and it could change the way people look at Bitcoin. And to me, man, it would be great to see that come to life. But who knows? Maybe somebody's listening right now. I know if I had that kind of money, I would just be like, go do it. Just go do it. Like, but you'll find that for sure. I would just say start. Yeah, just start. Just start. Just keep working at it.
The film will happen because I want it to be made. If for no one else, to show it to my family and my friends. Hopefully, that's gonna clear some things up. But if anybody wants to, I'm also trying to sell this as something that's very. Like at some point, I don't know exactly what your plan is with your media ventures, but I think that anything that's worth watching for Bitcoiners, it's going to be prime space to put corporate or open source anything, any brand or any Bitcoin message. And I'm not going to put ads in the project. Unless someone wants to monetize it differently and can do like a show and sell it their own way. But the way I see it, the way I can sell this is with producership credits in the beginning of the rolling credits. That's how the big movies do it. But you, for instance, I don't know, you can have product placement, all these things. This is because content worth for Bitcoiners to watch is going to be, I think, very rare. Yeah. Because Bitcoiners don't want to be bothered. They're probably living their life and they don't want to be disturbed with bad content.
Yeah, for
at
sure.
At least that's
yeah. I think so for sure. I think you're going to, I mean, who knows? Somebody's listening right now, Pedro, I'm telling you. And you're going to be like, car, guess what happened? Be like, told you. That's all it took, man. Just a thriller effect. That's what just what happens. I'm kidding.
But you
never know. So let's jump into rapid fire before we close this off. I got rapid fire for you. You ready?
Yeah.
All right. Since you're a filmmaker, you're a creative. What's one piece of film, art, music, whatever it is that you absolutely love? Doesn't need to be the best thing, but just like one thing that you.
Well, it's going to sound repetitive, but 2001 Space Odyssey is something that I don't have one favorite thing, but as you mentioned that, I just remember how deep that was because I had to research for a school paper and I learned so much that I had no idea.
Yeah, Stanley Kubrick. So he's one of my, like when I look at the people that I'm inspired by in history, it's like he's like up there with some others, but he's one of the ones I always go back and read interviews from or watch documentaries just over and over and over and over and over again. So yeah, I love that. Next question. What's one tool, whether on the digital side or the physical side, like, or yeah, whatever, like what is one tool that you absolutely cannot live without? Can't be your laptop though.
Well, it's the, probably the next best thing, which is my notebook. I have all these notebooks and I am always writing on them, writing or sketching.
Yeah.
This is where I annotate all the ideas before they become anything.
Yeah. Talk about that. Like, are you one of those people that just will sit there and think through these things while you write? Or are you somebody that just will walk around and then it comes to you? Like, where does that antenna?
I think most of the times I'm listening to a podcast or I'm reading something and I have an idea and then I stop it. I take notes and then I try to sketch it because I've been building the geometry for this. I've been trying to think this geometrically because this is how the film is being made. So every time people start talking about stuff, I'm already visualizing the components as the characters that were built for the film. So the node itself, when I hear a podcast or I'm reading a technical piece about a node, I'm visualizing how the parts of the node would be inserted into the visualization of the node that I've been working on. And the same thing happens to the network, the mining process, the cryptography. So every time I hear something interesting, then I draw it because that's how I'm seeing it. And if I can't draw it, I usually write really bad, like computer instructions to replicate that in Blender. So if it wasn't for that, I would have no ideas.
Wow. That's amazing. And then the last question, what's a memory that you can think of, or do you have a memory that you grew up with that you, to this day, you think that was the thing that got you on this path of, maybe not doing this film, but maybe putting the place where you're at now when you look back and you think like, oh, it was because I went to that class or whatever. Or was there anything like that you can think of how it got to where you're at today?
Yeah. Someone when I was really young showed me this Powers of 10 film, but it also, there's all these other, like I wouldn't be into Bitcoin if it wasn't for my, like, for instance, my mother used to complain about taxes, and that's when I was really young. And she wouldn't do this very often, but she did that one time when I was paying attention. And it just stuck with me forever. It was just like a moment in time. And so that's why I'm doing Bitcoin stuff for this. I'd spill my heart for you. I beg your pardon for you. I spell it out for you. I beg your pardon for you.